Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome along. My name's Peter, and I'm the host this afternoon, and it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker. AJ, for those of you who haven't met him, will be presenting some fascinating and inspiring information this afternoon that I think will help you in your soul development. AJ travels around the world running groups for interested people, and I feel extremely fortunate that he's come along to talk to us this afternoon, and I'd like you to show your appreciation by giving him a very warm Sunshine Coast welcome.
Still need my glasses, so got to them. How's everyone today?
Good.
Fragile, I heard somebody say. I'm fragile too, so that makes two of us. Yeah, I don't know about you, but remember last weekend on Sunday I suggested that you set your intention this week, and set your intention to feel your emotions and see what comes up. Did any of you try that out this week?
Yes.
Yeah? Did you find things happened this week?
Yeah.
For you emotionally? Yeah, it's interesting. So I've been crying for most of the week, and I don't think it's going to stop soon. So if I begin to cry while I'm talking with you, then you'll just understand why I walk out there. Do you understand?
Yes.
I'm working through a lot of emotions to do with unworthiness and being unloved and unwanted. And they're very deep emotions I'm finding, and very, 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 very difficult actually to stay in and access completely. And so I find I come into them and I might spend 3 or 4 hours in a day having a good talk about some of them, and then I get out of them again and then get into a state of anger for a little bit. And then I find I have to get back out of that and into that state again of dealing with the emotion. But I've felt fairly exhausted, and so today I feel fairly exhausted as well. So the sessions may not go as long as what we might have planned. Is that all right with everyone?
Yes.
Okay. But what I would like to do today is talk a lot about the divine path and what it's going to mean for you emotionally. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
And also, in particular, how to go about doing some emotional clearing work and what are the different things that you might be faced with in the emotional clearing work that you do. So that's what I'd like to focus on today. Mind you, if any of you have any questions about anything that you've seen in the DVDs or any questions that came from last week, feel free to ask them if you can. But what I'm going to do is try to stay on topic. Because I know a lot of you would like to know a lot more about dealing with your emotions and how to actually do that. So, All right. What I wanted to do firstly is just outline some very, very basic principles about the divine path as to what's involved on progressing in this way of the soul, or sometimes you might call it the way of the heart. And so what I would like to do is just outline some very basic principles. There's actually only 3 things that you're going to need to do on this path, so a child can understand these things. And that's the beauty of this path, is that because a child can understand them, it means that any single one of God's children can become at one with God as long as they do the work involved in becoming at one with God, in doing these 3 things, these just 3 things. So let's write down the 3 things first. What do you think they might be?
Experience your emotions.
All right, I'll put that down as number 3. Number 1 and number 2.
Have a passion for God.
Have a passion for God, and let's call this pray for God's love. Who hates the word pray? Okay, no worries. You're allowed to admit anything here, by the way. I'm going to define the word pray for you in a minute, and you'll see that it's not anything to do with religion generally. All right, second thing. Now, the second thing's really important because, and we'll talk more about it in a lot more detail later, but it's really important because you often hear terminology nowadays of what's my truth or your truth. I have to stay in my truth or your truth. And the truth is that you will not be able to become at one with God unless you learn God's truth. All right? And that is going to be very, very different from your truth. And that's part of the process that you'll be going through, is actually learning the difference between your truth and God's truth. All right. Now that's pretty confronting, isn't it? To actually believe that there's some way that you can actually get to know God's truth. There must be a way. And that way is going to be very, very important for you in your progression. If you refuse to accept God's truth, you will not ever become at one with God. Now, we'll talk more about that in a minute. The third thing. Humility. What's the definition of humility? Any ideas?
To stand under.
To stand under? That's being humble. Is that... is that what God wants us to do?
To feel for others.
To feel for others? Or that'd be more like empathy?
Yeah,
I suppose so. Good. We don't know everything?
Yeah, well, obviously we don't know everything. That's pretty easy.
To know the difference?
Can I define it as this? Being willing to feel every emotion that is inside of yourself. And in fact, not just being willing to feel every emotion inside of yourself, but actually wanting to feel every emotion inside of yourself. Can you see why that might be humility? Mm-hmm. There's a few shakes of the head.
It can be very vulnerable. You have to overcome vulnerability.
What causes you to be proud, or what causes you to hang on to your ego? Isn't it the fact that you don't want to feel some emotion inside of yourself in the end? So the only way you're going to be able to let go of this thing called ego or let go of pride is to actually feel and be willing to feel everything inside of yourself. That make sense? Yeah. So that's the definition of humility I'd like you to take away from yourself. Be willing to face, and not just willing, have a strong desire to face and feel every single emotion inside of yourself. So let's look at more at the definitions of these three things. What do I mean by pray? What I mean is to develop a desire or longing for God's love to enter into your soul. That's what I mean by pray. So when I say the word pray, it means having a longing in your heart to connect with God and to feel God's love entering you. Now, when I say longing, I'm going to use the word a pure, the word's pure desire. Can you see how that's fairly hard, actually? Isn't it? Like, it's very simple what we need to do on the divine path, but it's not easy. To have a pure desire, it means that every single feeling that I have inside of myself is going to be challenged. So let's say I have a feeling of unworthiness inside of myself. At that instant that I'm feeling that feeling, am I going to be able to receive divine love?
No.
Because I'm not having a pure desire anymore. My feelings are, I'm unworthy of your love, God. So as soon as I have that feeling, obviously my desire is no longer pure for God's love to enter me, and I will need to let myself be humble enough to feel that emotion of unworthiness. Right? Now, for me, I've been doing that really solid for the last 6 to 8 weeks now. I've been doing it for probably 5 years, but the last 6 to 8 weeks, really solid, trying to focus on feeling those feelings of unworthiness. And it takes you into some really dark places inside of yourself. And if you're unwilling to go there, then of course that unworthiness is going to be blocking that connection with God. You follow me? So when I say pray for God's truth, have a pure desire in your heart for truth. Not your own, but God's. But you also, of course, need to have a desire to feel your own. And also to feel the difference between what your truth is and what God's truth is. And that's really hard at times. Because, you know, when somebody comes up and bops you in the nose, what do you want to do? You know, there's a feeling of anger. I didn't deserve that. I want to get them back somehow, right? Now, is that what God does? No. Not what God does. So straight away, I'm in disharmony with God's truth. Even though it feels so unfair, I feel like I want to bop them back. I know that if I bop them back, I am actually in disharmony with God's truth. Right? And I'm going to need to feel the reasons why inside of myself I feel like bopping them back. And that might take a week to sort through all of those feelings, or a month even. Or maybe even a year, it just depends on how long we want to do with it. Definitely a year.
Excuse me, what if they bop you again? I mean, you're... I mean, is it not...
Then you get pure desire to pop them back.
That's why I said in the first century to turn the other cheek. There's a lot in that, if you think about it. So the answer is yes to your question.
So you know, if you love yourself enough as well, I mean, isn't it about feeling worthy yourself? Is it okay to let somebody abuse you?
If you really felt worthy, and this will get to the law of attraction a little later in our discussion, but if you really felt worthy, it's highly unlikely you would have attracted the event in the first place. And if you have attracted that event, and you're in a state of complete worthiness, which probably means you're at one with God by now anyway, then somebody hitting you won't have any effect on you whatsoever, emotionally. So either way you look at it, you're in the situation because of either the law of attraction, either because you're in a state of truth or in a state of error that you need to deal with. So if somebody has hit you, go into your emotions. Feel those emotions. That is what's going to help you no longer attract that event. Now sure, in that process that you go into the emotions, and we'll talk about this in a lot more detail, when you go into the emotions and feel the causal emotions, what will actually happen then is that you'll no longer desire to be around people who are going to hit you. But the truth is, you walk up to a person and as soon as you meet them, you'll know they'll be able to hit you, if you're in that state. And you will then decide, do I want to have much to do with this person at this moment? Or, you know, I can just love them but go on my way. So you would not even be, let's say we're in an abusive relationship. We would not even be in an abusive relationship if we were in the state of at one with God. So you can see how there's truth mixed with some error in amongst the whole thing. We'll talk more about those details after we've covered this kind of thing.
Would you explain that as an example about your crucifixion? Like law of attraction and turning the other cheek and you being at one, meaning it didn't really affect you emotionally at all?
No.
But physically?
Even physically it didn't affect me.
Did you have the choice to not have it you affected, or it just didn't?
A lot of people talk about the crucifixion in terms of an issue of the law of attraction. The truth is that I did attract it. Okay. And the truth is the reason why I attracted that event is because inside of me I had this strong desire to be in a state of truth wherever I went. Now, of course, what that's going to do is attract around you lots and lots of people who are in error. Mm-hmm. And kind of truth and error always will be in disharmony with each other. Now, those people in error wanted to harm me, of course. So that was their desire, to harm me. Now, at every single place that I went to, I had a chance to avoid that harm. But I made choices at times where I decided not to. Right? So there was a time, like 3 years before the crucifixion, where I was stabbed, for example, and I healed that straight away. So, you know, it didn't affect me. It didn't have any personal, emotional impact on me. In the crucifixion, the night before I died, quite a few spirits came and warned me if I stayed in the place that I was staying in, that it would be a high likelihood I would die the next day. And I chose, for other bigger reasons, to actually stay. Yeah. Because there were things that needed to be proven, which, no matter what I said, could never be proven without somebody putting them into practice. And one of those things was, how would anybody ever believe that what I was saying about death not being of any importance? How would anybody ever believe that there was no such thing really as death? The only way was for somebody to die that they knew, and that somebody to come back and actually stand in front of them and show them that they're still alive. Okay. And that's what I chose to do.
So it was a choice.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So I didn't, you know, obviously I wanted to put off my death as long as I possibly could. But by that stage, what had happened is that almost every person around me still didn't believe what I was saying to them about death. Even my own soulmate did not believe what I was saying to her about death. And so in the end, the only way, once you get to a certain point in presenting truth, the only way you can demonstrate it is by demonstrating it with your own life. That's what I chose to do.
You're not in the same situation this time, though, are you?
Well, I don't know. It may be at some point, but I don't think so. Most of you believe in an afterlife, do you not?
Yeah,
that you believe that there is something beyond? Yeah. Well, in the first century, that wasn't the case. There was this very, very hazy beliefs about afterlife, particularly amongst the Jews. Now, the Greeks were different, of course. You know, they had a lot stronger viewpoints about the afterlife. And, you know, Plato and Aristotle and all those kind of teachers that came sort of 700 or 800 years before myself, they all taught all of those things about the soul. But the Jews and the Jewish faith were very earthy. And in a lot of ways still are very earthy. That's why they focus so much upon their own country's defence. Because they're very focused on, you know, what's going on in the physical. Yeah? So they were decisions that I'd made at the time.
Thank you. Yeah.
Alright, so to pray means to have a pure desire for God's love, in the first instance. To pray for God's truth, have a pure desire for God's truth. Not your own truth, have a pure desire for God's truth. You're also going to need to have a pure desire to know your own truth too. But more importantly, you need to have a pure desire to know God's truth. And then thirdly, you'll need humility. And humility is? Having a desire. In fact, I would say having a passionate desire to feel all of your own emotions. Yeah.
How do you generate that? What's the process?
We'll talk about that as well. Because obviously when we start this process, it's very difficult for us to have a passionate desire about anything, in many cases, right? Or we might find we have a passionate desire for everything that feels good, but we have a passionate desire to avoid. So, you could say humility is a passionate desire to feel every emotion inside of myself, whether it is painful or pleasurable. Now that's tricky, isn't it? How many of you want to feel pain? There'll be a few who have gone through this process and in the end they want to feel everything, which means they want to feel pain, right? I certainly want to feel everything. So I want to feel my pain as well. The only way you're going to be able to progress on the divine love path is to feel and have a desire to feel everything inside of you. And let's face it, there's a lot of painful emotions inside of us, isn't there? Right? You think about this week. How many of you this week have felt unloved at some point? That's quite a lot, isn't it? Like, that's just 1 week of, and that's quite a painful emotion. Right? How many of you this week have felt jealous? Yeah. I have too, by the way. So I'm putting on my hand with this. How many of you this week felt angry with something? Right? How many felt annoyed? Just annoyed. Okay. Right. How many of you didn't want to feel those feelings? We need to have a passionate desire to feel those feelings. So how do we get from having a passionate desire to avoid those painful feelings to having a passionate desire to feel those feelings? Any suggestions?
Recognising that without that we can't know God.
True. So, in other words, how important is our relationship with God to us? How important is it to be at one with God to us? How important is it to know absolute truth? Do I have a real dedication inside of my heart to know absolute truth? Or am I afraid? You can see that fears are going to be challenged straight away, aren't they?
When we were talking before, I asked you about, you know, what is the purpose of this life that we're living? And I thought it'd be nice if you could share what your answer was to me for everybody, because perhaps that would help with motivation.
Perhaps. Not always, though. The purpose, obviously, of our life is for us to experience God's love. That's the purpose. That's the reason why God created you. It's exactly the same reason when you think about it, if you have a pure desire to have children. The reason why you had that pure desire to have children was so that your children could experience your love. Right? How many wasn't there? It was something else. It was an accident. In a pure sense, you can see that if we have a pure desire to have a child, then our pure desire will be to give that child all the love that we can give. In other words, to share our love. And in fact, that's why God made it that way, to teach us more about God. God has a pure desire to share her love with you. Right? And that's the reason for your creation, in fact. And that desire was so intense that the instant God had it, you came into being. I'm talking as a soul. Have everyone seen this? Is there any that have not seen the introductory DVDs? There's a few. Okay. Yeah, well, so there will be things I talk about today that may lose you a bit, if that's the case. If you can get to see them, that would be really good. Rather than go through them again for the majority, many of us have been through them once or twice already, so... rather than do that, what I'll do is we'll be referring to some of these things, and you might need to just do a bit of extra research for those who haven't seen it.
And we've got plenty of copies now in the office if they want them.
The DVDs? Mm. Awesome. And while I'm at it too, obviously it takes Peter quite a lot of money and time to get these things copied and everything. And I think you've put a donation tin up the back, haven't you, Peter, for anybody who wants to contribute to that. So... everything here is just contribution style. So if you would like to contribute to that, that'd be good.
So can I just say with that, what you were saying before, are you saying to feel your feelings and the purpose around that is, in a sense, healing to get to know yourself? To know yourself is also a way then to become one with God, to know God.
Yeah, let's just summarise the process here. Here's God. So... this is God. He is you. This is your half, you're a half of the soul, actually. So there's you. There's a connection that can be established between God and you. But your soul is your emotions, your feelings. Anything else, please?
Passions.
Passions. Desires.
Your memory.
Memories.
Aspirations.
And so forth, right? There's quite a... In fact, there are literally hundreds of characteristics or attributes of a soul. This is you. This is the real you. Not your body. Not your physical body or your spirit body. But the real you is actually behind those two things. It's your soul. And the only way that God connects with you is soul to soul. Now, what's love?
Emotion.
An emotion. So, if I'm going to feel God's love, what am I going to need to do?
Feel
my emotions. If I'm unwilling to feel my own emotions, how can I feel an emotion that God has for me? Very difficult, isn't it? How can you feel loved when you're not allowing yourself to feel any emotion? Obviously, you're not going to even know when you're loved, are you? But if you can allow yourself to feel these things, then what straight away happens is your soul becomes open to a connection with God. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, the connection is sometimes referred to as the Holy Spirit, right? And rather than get all religious on you, the Holy Spirit is actually a conduit. You could think of it like an electrical cord that connects God with you. So you can imagine yourself got a plug on your crown chakra, right? And God's got a plug, and there's this cord called the Holy Spirit. And God's just waiting to plug this cord into you. Right? Just waiting to plug the cord in.
It's always going the crown.
But it's in the soul. Of course it doesn't go in a crown physically, because this is our physical body, and we're talking about the plug's actually in our soul, right? The plug is in your feelings, your emotions, your passions and desires. What actually happens is when you open up yourself and you begin to have a desire for God's love to enter you, what that basically is uncovers your plug. And the Holy Spirit plugs into you. The Holy Spirit is this conduit. So you could think of it as a conduit. You know what I mean by that? A cord or a cable, a conduit, via which the love flows from God into you. Right? Now, the Holy Spirit is sometimes also called the Spirit of Truth. So what does that tell you about the Holy Spirit? The conduit, the plug. The plug can only go into you when you are in a state of truth. As soon as you are not in a state of truth, and I'm talking in relative to God's truth here, then there's a disconnection. And you need to use your will, your desire, your passion to sort out why you don't want to be in a state of truth. Now, it could be that you're just very, very angry with men. And, you know, and the only problem is that half, you could say half of God's qualities are masculine. So you're in trouble. You're denying half of God if you do that, right? Could be that, right? Or you could just be very upset with women, right? And half of God's qualities are feminine. So obviously you're not going to be able to feel love coming from the feminine side of God if inside of yourself you're angry with the feminine or the masculine. Can you see that? So this Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of Truth, is the thing, the conduit, that is established by one thing, and it's by prayer. And what did I define prayer as? The pure desire. Now, when you develop a pure desire in your heart to actually long for God, when you long for God, that begins opening up your soul. Now, how many of you, when you watch the DVDs, the very first DVDs about the introduction one of the universe, how many of you felt really different during that and afterwards? How many of you felt really different when you were watching it? Because your soul was beginning to open up. And as soon as your soul begins opening up, you start becoming more and more emotional. That's the natural result of your soul opening up. Emotional is good. Isn't it? So many of us feel it's bad, don't we?
Yeah.
How you look at the world today, isn't it geared for emotional suppression?
Yes, it is. Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, you go to work. Are you allowed to cry at work?
No.
Why is that? Doesn't make any sense. Like, it's 8 hours of your day and lots of stress. Of course you're going to want to cry at times of work, aren't you?
Right?
Yeah. And then they can give you things like stress leave. Why do they have to do that? Because you didn't cry. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, what we're desiring is God's love to flow through into the soul. But can you see why I'm talking also about praying for God's truth? Because this conduit that establishes the connection between you and God can't be established without truth, without you being in a state of truth in comparison to God, which is not the same as me saying you being in a state of truth in comparison with yourself or with the world around you even. The world around us is not in a state of truth, is it? If it was, would we even be having to sit here listening to these things? Of course we wouldn't. We'd already be in it, right? We would already all be at one with God. Would be right.
Does the physical body feel it as well, or is it only the spirit?
Initially it's hard for the physical body to feel the inflow of divine love, but as the feelings intensify, the feelings that change inside of the soul cause major changes in both the spirit and material bodies. So yes, the spirit and physical bodies will definitely feel the changes that are going on inside of the soul. Remember that this is a soul-to-soul connection. So we're not talking about anything physical here. We're not talking about any spirit-body mechanism, metaphysical, either. We're talking about the real you, which is your emotions, feelings, passions, and desires. That's the area of you that is the most powerful, and that is the area that connects with God. And that makes sense when you think about it, doesn't it? God has all of these feelings, the dominant one being love. They are all emotional, are they not? Yeah. How do you feel when you love another? Isn't it, doesn't it take up a lot of your life? It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
What are you, I can feel a lot of negative feelings about love there. If there's negative feelings about love, it's not love. It's something else. Trust me. Alright? Alright, so love is a beautiful, passionate, desirous thing, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's why everybody wants it, don't they? Because of that. Now, love is an emotion, so therefore I am going to have to be emotional if I am going to want to experience love completely. But what we often do is we say, love, that's great, I'm happy to be emotional when I'm experiencing love. But I'm not happy to be emotional when I'm experiencing pain or jealousy or anger or any of these other things. I'm not happy to be emotional then. Or the biggest one that usually we're not happy with is grief. If you have read many books about emotional work, I don't know how many of you have read books about emotional work, but there's some very, very good ones around nowadays. There's a man, John Bradshaw, have any of you heard of him? He made one called Homecoming. Very good book. And he mentions that grief is the healing emotion. Grief is the healing emotion. If you are not prepared to feel your grief, you will never heal.
Wanting to understand, believing in the scientific process.
Yep.
So our schooling and being a teacher, the passage of schooling teaches us to make sense of things, and that's in mind. It's make sense and measure and calculate. And
why do we need that?
Well, it helps us. It does help us to have understanding of where we're at and measure it against. It helps us to process.
It doesn't actually.
But it shuts down feelings.
Yeah. The truth is that our mind is meant to be, and the way God designed our mind is it's just meant to be the stupid servant of our soul.
You mean obedient?
Yeah, and stupid. It is stupid. Well, you think about your mind. you go and do something, and half the time in a day, you've got no idea why. Be honest. How much time in a day do you spend doing something, and if you really sat down and felt about it, you'd realise you didn't want to do it? You've got no idea why you're doing it. Why is that? Because you're not trusting your soul, and your mind has become dominant. You feel you have to do it. Right? You're not trusting what's inside of here. You're wanting to do it. You're wanting to do something different. Right? And this is the problem with your mind, is if you let your mind be dominant, you are going to do a lot of things in your life that you're going to regret later. How many have done things that have regretted later? Lots of us, right? Because we haven't followed our feelings about things, right? And I'm not talking about our feelings that are negative, because that's a different kettle of fish. I'm talking about feelings that are positive in terms of pure desire type of feelings. Right? When you follow those, everything always works.
So, AJ, how can you tell the difference between intuitiveness and the mind?
Yeah, well, intuition is from the soul. The mind is just the intellect, obviously. So the source of those two feelings, if you like, are totally different, right? Intuition is of the soul. And we'll talk more about sort of how to start trusting your intuition. Mind you, if my emotions in my soul are very negative, for example, if I have these huge feelings of unworthiness, where's my intuition going to lead me now? It's going to lead me down into attracting all of this unworthy things, triggering this unworthiness. I'm going to be treated unworthily, aren't I, with the law of attraction. So bear in mind that only when we connect in a way with God's truth is our intuition even trustworthy. Does that make sense?
AJ, I found that if a thought process goes away or it diminishes, it loses impact, I know I've gotten in the way.
Yeah.
But if a process comes from my soul and it's an intuition, it keeps its intensity and the desire remains constant. But it's a sensitive product kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. But I do find that when I get in the way, it diminishes. Yeah. And I don't have that follow through or that desire. So that might help.
That is often the case. But bear in mind that what we're talking about here is there are two different influences on the soul. We'll talk more about that in a minute. So let's say our mind. There's our mind. Get used to it. Your mind is no good at determining truth. Right? The reason why is because all the truths that God created are soul truths. In fact, there's a whole... The only area that you'll ever be able to progress to in the spirit world, if you trust your mind, is the sixth sphere. Because when you trust your mind, you're not trusting anything outside of your mind, generally. You've become self-reliant rather than God-reliant. Right? There's this whole area of truth, and in fact, the majority of the truths of the universe are based around soul truths. They're not based around the intellect at all. So if you are constantly trying to use the intellect to work out truth, eventually you're going to work out so much truth to the degree of a six-sphere spirit that you will not progress beyond that point. Right? Now, it's a lovely place to be, the six-sphere. Right? And even on the earth, it's a lovely place to be. There are many people on earth who are channeling spirits who are in that state. But it's not the soul truths.
Yes. With the mind thing, because I think I'm definitely mind dominant. We're using the example you gave before of someone bopping now. If I was to follow my the feelings I got, I probably would bop them back. But I use my mind to neutralise that. Like,
okay, yeah, this is the trouble, right? See, a lot of times the feelings inside of us are quite negative, right? And if we followed them, what would happen?
Disaster.
Yeah. How many of you felt like murdering someone this week? Nobody. Not this week. Last week there were.
It's a fortnightly thing.
It's a fortnightly thing. Yeah. It's only every payday or something. Yeah, quite often we will have a desire that is negative. Very true. Now, when we have a desire that it's negative, what do we do with it? Now, if we follow just our emotions under those circumstances, then obviously we would probably act on that emotion and do something very negative, which would actually harm our soul again. But what we need to do, if we are fully choosing, if we are humble, what we will do is we will feel that emotion. Oh, I feel like killing Joe Blow. I wonder what emotion is underneath that I don't want to feel. What emotion inside of me is underneath that I don't want to feel? Oh, well, he just stole my $1 million that I had in my bank. And now I'm destitute. What emotion did that bring up for me? What emotion did it bring up for you? He stole all of your money.
Lots of
fear. Okay, so fear.
Anger,
but these are not emotions. These are capping emotions. What's underneath those?
Insecurity.
Rage. Rage is another capping.
Insecurity.
I'm unsafe. And I don't want to feel unsafe. So in order to not feel unsafe, what am I willing to do? Get angry. And in order to... And then I feel really angry. I feel, in fact, in a rage. So I'm willing now to even consider murdering the person. Right? Why? Because I wasn't humble enough to feel the underlying emotion. So when I say feel the emotions, what I'm actually talking about is feeling the causal emotion, not feeling the effect-based emotions. And we'll deal with this more in a minute. Do you understand the difference between a causal emotion and an effect emotion? An effect emotion is anger or fear. They're all effects. They're not the real reason why you're feeling what you're feeling. They're just the reasons that you select in order to not feel the underlying emotion. They're the choices you make so that you don't have to feel the underlying emotion, which is even more difficult for you to feel. Do you follow me? So, in the case, all of my money has been stolen. I'm feeling fear, but that's not the real emotion, right? The real emotion is actually underneath the fear. I'm feeling anger, but that's not the real emotion. The real emotion is underneath the anger. That's the emotion I need to let myself feel. And I choose anger, and I choose fear, and I choose these other things in order to not feel the underlying emotion, the causal emotion, the core emotion that created these other feelings. So when I'm talking about becoming soul dominant, I'm saying don't do those things, because those things are actually the mind choosing to deny the underlying emotion. When you no longer deny the underlying emotion, whatever that is, then those emotions will not come up in you. So one day this week, I think it was about Wednesday, I was feeling quite angry Wednesday. And for me, anger is sort of like a brief thing, like a few minutes. And normally, I usually just sit down straight away and then just look at what's going on inside of me. Why am I feeling this anger? And what came up for me was I was angry with my soulmate. I was angry with my girl about something she did in the first century, actually. Somebody said, get over it. But you see, for me, with my emotions, what's happening is every time I have memories, it's like the thing happened yesterday. You follow me? So it's a bit like if you're an abuse survivor and all of a sudden you have a memory of the abuse that you survived when you were younger. It's like that memory, it's like that abuse happened yesterday to you. That's how it feels. Like it's a very strong, powerful emotion. So even I know it sounds funny, but even my first century emotions feel like they happened yesterday. And what happened in the first century was my soulmate did cheat on me. Right? We were together and she left. And I was just feeling lots and lots of anger about that. And I sat down and had to look at what I don't want to feel. I was feeling jealous anger. And a bit of sexual sort of anger as well, you know, like sexual jealousy. And I was trying to, you know, initially I just got into the anger and I was... this is going to sound funny. I've got a 40-acre property and I was pulling out a mother of millions, you know, the scourge of this land. And I'm still trying to work out... God must have created it for some reason. I'm still trying to work out. That's a different story. Anyway, I'm pulling out his mother of minions, you know, grumbling to myself and being upset about my soulmate cheating on me in the first century. Why you'll find it so funny. It wasn't funny. Anyway, I allowed myself to go into the underlying emotions. And a lot of them come up, like being unwanted, undesirable. You know, all of these feelings about that I was feeling about myself now, which, by the way, I didn't feel in the first century, but because of these reflected emotions through my mother's injuries this time around, I have all of these emotions now based on those memories. And so I was feeling unloved, undesirable, unwanted, and quite a number of other things, which I finished up trying to connect to, and I'm still trying to connect to. Does that make sense? The jealousy and the anger were just suppressing what was underneath. Right? And I didn't want to go with what's underneath because it felt too painful. So at that moment, was I fully choosing to be humble? No. I can only be, when I'm humble, I will feel the underlying causal emotion, the one that I'm trying to avoid with my anger.
Jack, are you trying to get back to the event in this childhood that made you feel like that, or are you just connecting with the feeling?
And in the end, if you connect with the feeling, you will probably always get back to the event. But connect to the feeling. Any of you who have survived childhood abuse, particularly sexual abuse, would know that you blocked out many of your memories. You repressed them, right? Why did you repress them? Because you didn't want to feel the emotional attachment to that memory. So what often happens is we have an event that occurs that creates an emotion. We don't want to feel that emotion, so we tune out of that emotion. And that also means that the event is no longer remembered either. We repress it. Right? And this is what all of us do with emotions that we don't want to feel. We finish up going into states of denial. And there's lots of different states of denial, and I'll list a few. I got a few little quotes, actually, from the Homecoming book that have helped me a lot. And I'll list some of those things for you, too, that might help you.
I don't quite understand what you said about your emotions, because you've experienced from your mother's emotions, now you're feeling the betrayal in the first century.
All right, let's just answer briefly then. I've answered this before, but let's answer it briefly. Your soul contains memories. When you get into a 22nd sphere condition, those memories remain in your soul, but they are not emotional. They are just events. That make sense? When you incarnate, the biggest emotion, you incarnate into the womb of your mum, right? And your dad is in your life too, obviously. And those emotions together, once you incarnate, are impressed upon, you're in there, right? They're impressed upon your soul. And every one of those memories then take on an emotional perspective based on the emotions that your mother and your father both feel. You follow me? That's what happens when you reincarnate. So this is why reincarnation is not very good if you want to clear away load. This is why, and honestly, most Eastern religions say that reincarnation is necessary for clearing karma. The truth is, that if reincarnation was necessary for clearing karma, no single person on earth would ever get cleared, or in the spirit world would ever get cleared of all the damage. In the spirit world, people progress from one sphere to the next sphere to the next sphere to the next sphere, and they don't come back to earth to do that. And the reason why they can do that is because they can clear away their karma as they progress in the spirit world. So there is no need to reincarnate for the purpose of clearing away old baggage. You follow me? Yep.
Why do we take on parents or their emotions impressed on child so that you can help and them feel their feelings?
Well, let's look how God firstly created it. God firstly created it so the parents had no emotional baggage. Now, if the parents have no emotional baggage, when the child incarnates, the child would have no emotional baggage. Now, that'd be great, wouldn't it? You would have no problems going through your life. You'd be happy from the moment you were born. You wouldn't be born crying. Do you think you'd be born crying? Of course not. Right? You'd be born smiling. Yeah? And your whole life would be a joyous experience, right? Now, God created it that way. But what man has done is made a choice to walk away from God. And in that choice, what we do is we become self-reliant. And in the choice of becoming self-reliant, we then choose a lot of things that are disharmonious with love. And in the process of that, every one of those disharmonies with love becomes a part of our emotional being. So my mum, and her mum, and her mum, and her mum, and I'm not just saying mum, my mum and dad, and her, their parents, and their parents, and their parents, and their parents, have passed down, if you like, this constant emotional baggage onto each subsequent generation. That's not what God intended to do, to happen. But God knew it could happen if a person walked away from God. And as we walk closer to God, this will not happen. And in the future, in around, probably about 100 years or so time, there will be lots and lots and lots. In fact, the majority of people on earth being born will not have emotional damage.
So could you say that emotions are actually hereditary in the sense that, for example, my mother and my sister had both been raped?
Yep.
And so does that mean that it was from, it was even possibly my grandmother and further up those types?
Definitely.
Until the generation chooses to deal with that, then that...
That's right. So if your sister dealt with the rape emotionally completely, her child, if she had a girl child, would not be raped. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, I'm not saying that there's lots of faults here. What happens is the emotional damage that rape causes to the woman is it's obviously very damaging. But it's not quite as damaging as the emotional damage caused by abuse, sexual abuse as a child, obviously. But that's the most damaged sexual-based crime that you can commit to anyone. And usually, people who have been raped have also had some kind of childhood sexual abuse in many cases. So what happens is if the parent doesn't clear away that emotion and the child incarnates into their womb, in the case of a mother, then if the child is a girl child, they're going to accept all of the feminine things or the feminine-based injuries that mother's going to have. Agreed? Mm-hmm. And so then it becomes like a subsequent generational thing. There's a message in the Paget messages where Luke talks about passing down sin from generation to generation, multi-generational sin. It's worth reading because it's about that. It's about the emotions that are being passed down from generation to generation. And even beliefs get passed down in the same manner. They're all emotions. They get passed down in a similar manner. Yep. So every single emotion you had in yourself when you were, when you became pregnant, for all of you ladies that have been pregnant, automatically got passed in to your children at that moment. And that's why they woke up crying. Because you need to cry, actually. They're just reflecting your emotions, you see. The beauty of a child is they're a pure reflection of your emotions that you are not letting yourself feel.
So, when does that child who's got those emotions from the mother, when does that child clear the mother's emotions?
It may not ever do it until it passes into the spirit world, and even then for many hundreds of years. It just depends on it exercising its will to actually...
Which is that's feeling the emotions coming.
To experience the emotion.
To feel it.
To actually feel it and release, yeah.
Is it easy to process emotions in the spirit world?
Some parts of it are easier and some parts of it are harder. Perhaps if I can illustrate. It's easier in the spirit world with emotions sometimes because you can see the emotion flowing out of you when you're experiencing it. So like if you have anger coming out of you, you'll see it like barbs coming out of you. And there'll be a colour coming out of you as well. And it will be noxious to everyone around you. So you'll see it. You'll see it actually occurring if you're able to feel, if you want to see it, you will see it. So that sometimes makes it easier, yes, to say to myself, well, yes, I do have anger, or yes, I do have grief, or yes, I do. And it makes it easier for me to recognise my emotion. But on the other hand, it can be quite hard, too. You think about it. If there is no law preventing you from doing anything in disharmony with love, I will shorten that to anything wrong from God's perspective. Right? And if there's no law, then what are you going to do if you feel like doing it? You're just going to do it, aren't you? So let's say you were a man on earth and you never raped a woman ever on earth. Right? But you had a feeling quite often inside of you that you wanted to. Right? When you pass, what's going to happen? That emotion is going to be pretty strong inside of you, and you'll realise that there's no law preventing you from trying to do that. And what are you going to do? You're going to come to earth and perv on every naked woman? You're going to do, aren't you? You think about it. If that's what you want to do in your heart, you would do it, wouldn't you? Now, it's very hard then to stop yourself from doing it and deal with the underlying emotional reason why you do it. Do you follow me? That created a lot of fear in a lot of you, that statement. Why is that? Why do you feel fear? How many of you ladies hate feeling like you're being sexually objectified? That's an emotion you will need to deal with. Because that's an emotion too. That will attract these kind of people around you who will sexually objectify you until you feel that emotion. Does that make sense? The law of attraction, if you have a feeling inside of yourself that you hate being sexually objectified, you will attract men who sexually objectify you. In order for you to experience what's underneath that emotion. And we'll talk more about the law of attraction in a minute.
AJ, you've had a divine connection with God. God wouldn't allow that to happen, would he?
When you say God wouldn't allow that to happen, God allows every single person to have free will. So a person can attempt to sexually objectify you. Of course, if it has no effect on you, then will it matter to you? It won't, will it?
I'm talking about the spirit form.
I am talking about either form. Yeah, I'm talking about either form. So if you're at one with God as a spirit, would you even have a feeling that you want to, you know, project sexual energy at somebody who doesn't want it from you? You wouldn't, would you? But if you are not at one with God, you may have that desire. But if you're at one with God here on earth, wouldn't you care if they tried to do it? It'd just bounce right back off you, wouldn't it? It wouldn't have any effect on you. It wouldn't affect your emotion.
And you wouldn't attract it.
And in the majority of cases, you wouldn't even attract it. Yeah. Is that... Make sense? We'll talk more about the law of attraction as we go on. Did that answer the question that we started with, which was the memories? So my memories from the first century, right? That was the question that was first asked. My memories, so you're looking at me, here's my soul, my memories from the first century. And when I incarnated in this century, all of those memories got emotional attachments to them because of the emotions of my parents. So now I'm having to re-experience all of these memories through this emotional filter of my parents. And I didn't have to do that in the first century. So.
Wouldn't you have chosen some without those?
There's no one on earth without them.
So, AJ, has anyone got into this state that we're talking about?
On earth?
Has anyone achieved it?
Only once. But I feel that all of you here will achieve it.
What makes you feel that?
Because you have a desire to, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah. And you, don't you have a desire to keep seeking truth? Don't you have a desire to feel bliss?
Yes.
Isn't that why you're here?
Yes.
So now that you know how to do it, won't you do it?
Yep.
Of course. So yeah, the majority of you here, within a very short period of time, and when I say short period, I don't mean,
I mean,
give yourself a few years. Like, it's impossible for you to deal with all of your emotions like that.
Yeah.
The reason why? Because it would kill you. It would kill you. Like, most of us have such big, sad and grieving type emotions to deal with, that if we could feel them all instantly, we wouldn't cope with it emotionally inside of ourselves. We'd die from the experience. So you need to learn to trust that your soul will do it at the speed that you want to. Of course, you can control the speed. So if you have a pure desire to feel every emotion, then the speed will be as rapid as it can possibly be given your emotional damage. But if you have a desire to suppress the painful emotions, then the speed is going to be...
It's just not convenient right now.
Not yet. I'm aware. There goes one third of my life, I'm aware. All right. Every time that I'm with some friends, there goes maybe another, one fifth of my life. Yeah. Every time I'm asleep, well, you can actually choose to do it when you're asleep.
Yeah.
So, you know, but then again, you might be having quite a bit of fun when you're asleep. So let's say, get rid of another fifth of your life there. And by the end, what are we left with? Like 1/20th of our life where we're dealing with our emotions. Now, of course, if it's like that, then it's going to just dribble out, isn't it?
Mm.
All right? But if we actually fully choose, if we fully commit to dealing with all of our emotions, no matter what they are, whether they're painful or pleasurable, what will happen is you can stay in a state where you're dealing with it sort of 80, 90, 100%. In the end, the only time you'll become 100% of the time is when you're at one with God. But you can be up there in the 50 to 60-70% mark of dealing with your emotions as they occur. But you're going to probably have to make some different choices in your life to do that. So how many people would, their boss would not allow it? Like the majority probably, yeah. You know, if they noticed you crying all the time of day, they'd want to go and send you to a psychiatrist to stop you crying.
So why is it that people choose work and a profession that doesn't allow them? I guess, is the soul's passion the doorway to into a space, a comfort zone to be able to feel your emotions? And so do you lead a life that allows you to be at one with God and reach that? Do you want to feel your passions and follow them? Like, I have a passion for traveling. It's like, when I'm traveling, it's like I'm at the core of myself. I know exactly what's going on, and intuitively, it's like I have eyes in the back of my head.
Yeah.
So are those attributes of your soul exact doorways where you...
Yes, and the attributes of your soul where you want to deny are the same. So if you do, like, if you have a true desire in your heart right now to not deal with pain, then that's what's going to happen. What's going to happen is you're going to attract lots of situations where you'll be able to avoid your pain. Right? That's a natural consequence.
Workaholic.
A workaholic is a person who does that. Yeah. Let's call it all, let's put it all in one big bracket, call it addictions. Right? Addictions are all denial. Now, when I say addictions, I'm not just talking about like alcohol or drugs or sex or any of those kind of things. I'm talking about even just day-to-day things where we're addicted to certain things. Who's addicted to hugs? It's a form of denial.
Wow.
means you get withdrawn if you don't do it.
Well,
is that the form of addiction in the hugging? If you don't do the hug, you don't feel...
If somebody doesn't hug you, how do you feel?
Rejected.
Rejected or whatever. So what are you avoiding? Feeling the feeling of rejection. Like if somebody doesn't hug you, there's this... I think I told you this last Sunday, where there was this couple who walked in the door and he had all these neediness emotions. He wants hugs all the time, right? So I went up and hugged her and left him alone. He got quite upset. Right? Well, it wasn't loving for me to hug him, was it? Because what was he trying to do with the hug? Avoid his emotions. Is it love for me to help you avoid your emotion?
No.
It's love for me to help you access your emotion. So if we want to have all the club that we all avoid each other's emotion, then we skirt around emotion and make each other feel good, is that going to be the path, you think?
No.
Isn't that
called therapy?
Yeah. Isn't that called therapy? All right.
Mm-hmm. Did you think about that, or just intuitively kind of delay? Or did you sort of think, I'm not going to hug you?
I didn't think about it at all. Yeah, I didn't think about it at all. And I love Michael, like the guy, he's a really lovely person. But I didn't think about it at all. And I felt his offence, like he was offended. He felt that I was treating him inconsistently. So, and when you start feeling at the soul level, a lot of people around you will start telling you that you're being inconsistent. But in reality, what you're doing is you're being consistent with their emotion. You follow me? Yeah. So when you're consistent with a person's emotion, what will happen is you'll feel whether that emotion is a pure desire or not. And if that emotion is a pure desire, and you have a feeling that is also pure, you will respond. Right? But if the emotion is an impure desire, you will not help them to satisfy their own impure desires. And when I say impure, I mean out of harmony with love all the time.
Okay, so facing the real pain is really difficult. Is it as simple as just simply saying, "On Jenny tells Jenny, I'm going to do this"? Is it as simple as that? And then when you're in it, is there anything that you can do to help unblock, help
release?
Yeah.
Certainly. We'll talk about that in a lot of detail over the next couple of days, actually. Mm. Right. In answer to your first question, though, how many of you have told yourself you want to be happy? How many of you are actually happy all the time? So does telling yourself anything really work? Now, I know that might sound pretty basic, right? But isn't it true? Like, if you intellectually tell yourself something, it doesn't actually mean anything to the soul. Because it's the emotions that are governing everything that's happening within you. Right? So how are you going to be happy? The only way is for every single emotion inside of you that is unhappy, to be out of you, isn't it? How does it get out of you? Yeah, it's not writing them down on a piece of paper, screwing it up, throwing it in the fire, so
I release you.
It's not that. That does not work.
But you don't always know why you're blocked up. You don't always know.
Yeah, I realise that. Yeah. Yeah, like I was totally clueless this week. I'm totally clueless a lot of the time, really. Let's look at the reasons for the blocks, all right? The denials, right? Now, there's a few things. This comes from, I think I had page 67 on the homecoming book of John Bradshaw. By the way, the book John Bradshaw is very, very good for dealing with, that John Bradshaw wrote called Homecoming. Is very, very good for working through emotional pain from childhood. Right? Anyway, this is what he said about denial. Well, he's actually said there's lots of forms of denial, right? So we'll just rub that off, and we'll just put on these different forms. There's denial, which is, it's not really happening. see this a lot when this began when we were children. The child just hurt its foot in pain. Comes up to mummy crying. Mummy puts the child on her breast, taps the back, says, "There, there, there, you don't need to cry, it wasn't that bad." Right? So what's that? It's not really what you feel it is. And that's where a lot of this begins, right? How many times do you do that in your life? Like, you have a feeling that, hang on a sec, my husband's disconnected from me today.
Oh, it's probably just my imagination.
It's probably just my imagination, yeah. It's probably not really happening. Repression, he defines as... It never happens. Very big thing with childhood abuse of all types, but particularly childhood sexual abuse, is complete repression. It never happened to me. My whole life is showing to me that it actually happened to me, but it never happened to me. Overseas, I was talking to people who, a lot of people who have been abused as children, and often it began with, it never happened to me, and then after they started dealing with different emotions, it all of the memories started flowing back of it actually happening to them. But before then, the only proof they had it happened to them was their law of attraction, and they didn't trust their law of attraction. So if your law of attraction is telling you that you've been abused as a child, you've been abused as a child. Whether you remember it or not. It's immaterial. You've been abused as a child. Or your mother has, and it's the emotion has entered you. Or your father has, and that emotion has entered you.
So, Jen, how do you know that that's not one of these spirits coming to dump their stuff on you and give you this past life experience?
A spirit will only come and dump their stuff on you if they're attracted to you. Why are they attracted to you? Why would a spirit who's, say, been abused as a child come to you? Because they feel the same emotion inside of you. That's the law of attraction that works perfectly in every case. So even if it is a spirit influencing you, then there is something inside of you that caused that attraction. So don't be afraid of spirit attractions. They're great. They tell you exactly what's going on inside of you. They're attracted to you for a reason. Yeah?
Right. How can you tell if that has happened, that you have attracted a spirit? What do you notice?
The truth is that all of you attract in a day many spirits. Some of them will stay with you because they feel a deep rapport with you. They feel an attraction to you based on the emotions that you are feeling inside of yourself, that you're probably not conscious of, but they're there inside of yourself. So you don't need to worry about it, even if it is happening. The key is, deal with the emotions inside of yourself that cause it to happen. Right? Yeah. So there's lots of ways to tell, I suppose you could say. You know, if thoughts just pop into your mind all the time that are along your emotional injury line, then sometimes those thoughts are going to be coming from spirits. But if, in the end, they can't drop a thought into your mind without you already being resonant with it, right? So there must already be a seed inside of yourself that has that attraction. You follow me?
AJ, can they deplete your energy? Can they actually take your energy field?
Oh, totally, yes. But the only way that can again happen is because you are not dealing with an emotion that caused the attraction. Then they connect to you. And then they can certainly deplete your energy in that particular part of your body. So lots of cancers, for example, particularly childhood cancers, are caused by spirit attachment. Right? Spirit attachment is one of the largest causes of disease on earth today.
Wow.
Right? But how can the spirit attachment occur? Because the emotion inside of you attracts them. Now, I think last week I mentioned the lady in Greece who had diabetes, I think.
Mm.
Yeah, for those who were here. So she had diabetes 17 years through a spirit attachment. But her emotion caused the attraction. Right? So once we talked to the spirit and got the spirit to move on, she still needed to deal with that emotion. Because if she doesn't, what's going to happen? Another spirit will come back and find that injury and attach.
So can you see if that's happening in somebody?
Certainly, almost anyone can see if it's happening. You can even ask yourself. Lay yourself down on the table, hang a pendulum over the top of your third chakra, and ask yourself. The pendulum will rotate in a clockwise direction if you're telling the truth, and it will stop rotating if you're not. Do all of you know this?
No.
No? Okay. Your soul's emotions causes all of these flows of energy. Remember, emotion is energy in motion, right? So your soul's emotion causes all of these flows of energy occurring in your body. The flows of energy cross over to these meridians. These meridians are called chakras, right? Now, those chakras, the seven main chakras, are where, I think it's, 192 meridians or something, cross over. At those locations, when you are in complete tune with yourself, the chakra will energetically rotate anything above it in a clockwise direction. Is that a clockwise direction?
Yeah.
Looking down on it.
Yeah.
Now, you can ask yourself, if you have an open chakra and it's rotating in a clockwise direction automatically, you can then ask yourself questions about what you feel about something at your soul level. I remember when somebody first did it with me, he laid me down on a table. This was a long time ago, but it's 12 years ago. He laid me down on a table, and I was feeling myself to be in love with someone I wasn't with, right, at the time. And he holds the thing over my third chakra. He says, "Do you love this lady?" And I saying yes, and the thing stopped there. So the truth was?
No.
That's one way to find out the truth. Did I accept it?
No.
The saying opposites attract. So I'm wondering how you actually attract somebody that you're opposed to that type of character.
We're getting off the subject a bit, topic-wise, but just briefly, most of the time attractions on Earth are caused through emotional injuries being compatible. Say that again. Most of the time attractions on Earth are caused by emotional injuries being compatible. In other words, we have codependent attractions. Right? I do something. You see this a lot in relationships, right? Yeah. And the reason why is because we have codependent attractions in most cases. When you clear away all of your emotions, you'll get to the point where your attractions will be real. They won't be based on injuries anymore. They'll be based on desires. Pure desires. So they'll be totally different.
So you are saying you can get to a point where you deal with all your emotions. Totally. You can be emotional.
I wouldn't even be here if I didn't like that. And honestly, the truth is I would have gone like that if I didn't believe that at some points in my life.
But that's real. What you're saying is real.
Try it and see.
Then if I continue to work through my stuff and the generational stuff, yep, I will get to a point where I won't attract the wrong kind of person in my life.
Nope.
I mean, that's hallelujah, that's life.
Yeah, yeah. And you'll see this start happening in a lot of different areas. Let's say, what often happened with myself is that I'd come up with an emotion. There'd be a very traumatic time dealing with the emotion. I'd get through the emotion, then all of a sudden everything around me would automatically change without me having to do anything, right? And so forth. This would happen on a regular basis. So just take notice of your life, observe your life. You'll see it happening, right? So, but when you deal with a causal emotion is what I said, remember?
Mm. Yeah.
When you deal with a causal emotion, everything will change. If you deal with only effects, then will anything change?
No.
No.
How do you dig out those causal emotions?
We'll talk more about that after we talk about this.
Just one little question relating back to the pendulum.
Yep.
You said it shows your truth. Well, is it truth?
It's your truth.
Your truth, not divine truth.
Not God's truth. It only shows you your truth. Yeah, but your truth at the soul level, at the emotional level, not what you think is the truth. Right? There's a big difference between those two things, right? What you think and what you feel are totally different to each other.
Just while we're on the pendulum, I wasn't going to bring it up. Yeah. I was getting off track. But, I use a pendulum quite a lot in my work, but I often wonder sometimes. It works for me at work in a healing situation. It tells me a lot of crap when I'm not doing that. But I just wonder what it is. I just hold it in my hand, I have my palm chakra.
Yeah.
What is it that, I mean, it's very real, it's very accurate in my work situation. Mm-hmm. Is that a spirit working with that or something?
No, it's your energy at the soul level working with that. So it's the emotion at the soul level working with that. Now, you can ask a spirit to connect to it, and the spirit will then work with it. So a lot of people, I don't know how many of you are mediums yet, or not, a lot of people do it with a pendulum first. Like they start taking an interest in spirit communication with a pendulum first. You've got to be very careful, though, because you don't know what spirit's connecting to the pendulum. What spirit's going to connect to the pendulum? The spirit who's the closest to your emotional condition. That's the spirit who's going to connect to the pendulum. Whether you ask for someone else or not, the law of attraction is in place. God's laws work 100% of the time. So so what that means is, if I have a heap of unworthy feelings within me, what kind of spirit am I going to generally attract?
Unworthy.
Well, probably a spirit who wants to use my unworthiness for their own benefit, right?
Manipulate.
Wants to manipulate me. Let's say I have anger. What kind of spirit am I going to attract? Probably a spirit who wants to manipulate that anger to get something for themselves. Right?
How can they get anything for themselves?
There's some really good books you need to read about all of that. The whole series of Robert James Lee's, which are on those CDs, the Through the Mist, the Life Elysian, and the Gate of Heaven, there's lots of different experiences in there where spirits manipulate events on Earth in order to get a satisfaction of an emotion within themselves. And he explains many of those situations. Yeah. So books like that are really worth reading. Yeah. And they're on the DVD, the CDs that we've got at the back. And it's under the Divine Truth part, and it's called Robert James Lee's. R.J. Lee's is the author, and the three books were Through the Mist, The Life Elysian, and The Gate of Heaven.
Do you actually have to deal with this sort of dealing with spirits and communicating with them on your divine love path, or can it just be, I'm connected to God and it's just me and God, and I don't have to worry about all them or talk to them or deal with them?
Totally. Yeah.
Great.
It's all about your connection with God in the end, right? The spirit side of things you will probably take interest in as you progress, because it is interesting of what's actually going on around you and why and how things are being influenced. So it's very interesting. Mm-hmm. But it is not important for you on with your connection with God. However, one thing I would like to say is that your guide will help you a lot in accessing your emotions if you can trust your guide. So all of you have a spirit who is a guide, guiding you. Now, as soon as you desire God, the spirit who's guiding you will also be a spirit who's connected with God from an emotional point of view. So in other words, a spirit on the divine love path. And that spirit can help you a lot deal with your own emotions, if you want them to. It all gets down to your desire. They will respect your desire completely. So another way to tell that you've got a spirit with you who is not on the divine love path is, do they respect your desires, or do they want to get you to do other things? Right? A spirit on the divine love path will always put your will as their priority in dealing with you, your free will. Now, we can talk a lot more about spirit stuff later. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's keep going with denial.
No, I deny.
Why Why doesn't anybody want to talk about this?
What was that?
One of the things that I often do with people is to say, we need to at some point deal with all those childhood emotions that occurred, you know, things that occurred through our childhood events that we need to release. And you know what most people say? But I don't remember what happened. And the reason why we don't remember what happened is because we're in a state of disassociation. We want to not remember what happened. And then a lot of people also say to me, oh, but I can't deal with my emotions because I can't remember what happened. The truth is you will remember what happened when you want to deal with your emotions.
If the experiences that come up in your life are opportunities to explore whether you have actually dealt with your emotions,
totally.
To then bring up the memory.
Totally. The law of attraction will tell you if you've dealt with something or not. Mm. Totally. So if your law of attraction is, like, let's say, partner after partner after partner, I'm getting a constant stream of partners who treat me as if I'm unworthy. Mm. What's that telling me? I have not dealt with the emotion of unworthiness within me. Mm. I have not. Whether I think I have or not, I have not. The truth is, the law of attraction will attract exactly what you've dealt with or not dealt with. Yep. Okay.
What if you do, like, you don't always attract those same partners, and then you do attract and you have that once in a while? Is that just, you're still obviously having that emotion?
Yeah, so
but it's not something so constant.
I was talking to a lady in Dallas where this kind of thing happened to you. The first relationship she attracted was an abusive man who violently abused her. She eventually got enough courage and dealt with enough of that emotion to actually leave that man. The next relationship she had, the man gave her the silent treatment all the time. So he was still abusive, but just in an emotional way, no longer in a physical way. So she'd worked her way through a lot of the physical abuse issues, but she'd yet to deal with the emotional abuse issues, right? So in that relationship, she worked through quite a few of those issues over a period of 10 years or 12 years. And eventually that relationship broke up as well. And now she's single again and not in a relationship. And we were talking about a new relationship and what's going to happen there. This is what happens to you in your life if you choose to be not on the divine path. Because if you choose to be on the divine path, there's a very good chance you'll deal with all of those emotions in a few years. And after that, the relationship you choose will actually be a perfect relationship for you. Right? Until that time, often what we're doing is we're dealing with smidges of it. Mm. We're dealing with that aspect, this aspect, that aspect, this aspect.
Or just run from them all.
Or we're running from them all.
Just like, oh, thanks, I don't want to deal with that, so you know what.
Yeah, yeah. And what will happen is that if we desire to run from them all, then our life will also be constructed in such a way that our desire will also be fulfilled. So in other words, who feels flat chat busy all the time, not enough time to even sit down and spend any time with themselves? Is that you? This was what I was like. Yeah. Is that you? If that's you, that is because right at this moment you do not have a pure desire to deal with your emotions. Follow me? Yeah. And I know that's hard to face, because it was hard for me to face that too, you know. But that's what I was like. I used to work 120 hours a week and do all that stuff. Anger is comes under that, does it not? Whenever I'm saying to somebody else, it's your fault that I'm feeling what I'm feeling, right? Then I'm in a state of projection. I'm in a state where I am no longer taking responsibility for my own emotions. Right? So I'm jealous. Whose fault's that? Well, it might not be my fault. It might be my parent caused it. But if we talk about what's going on inside of me, I am denying an emotion. inside of me underneath that jealousy, right? So I need to allow myself to look at what that emotion is. This is what we often do, though. We blame someone else for what our life has attracted. And I just want to make a comment. It is also, have any of you seen these books, The Way of the Heart and all those things? Yeah. You've seen their stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah? First lesson, Way of the Heart is? Let me read it.
Who's that by, AJ?
Well, I channeled it through this man called JM.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
James Twyman?
Sorry?
Is it James Twyman?
John Mark Hammer.
Oh,
Josh, that's
gorgeous.
But AJ, why do you sound so different? Because I've got all the on CDs, The Way of the Heart.
Yep.
And the vocabulary and the vernacular is so different to yours.
Because every time you channel, you actually have to use the person's vocabulary and vernacular. You're actually, the way it happens is the soul injury and soul's damage of the person, or even the soul characteristics of the person, you've got to reflect everything through that. And so that is something that most people are not aware of with mediumship. The medium affects the actual characteristic of the individual. Right. The truth is that nothing which you are experiencing is caused by anything outside of you. What's that saying? The opposite. That if I'm experiencing something, it must be to do with you. Yeah. So, sometimes I'm at a group and the whole group is just angry with me. I don't know why I'm such a man. No, they're all angry with me because I've said something that has triggered them, right? And so they're angry at me, so they're projecting at me that it's all my fault that they're feeling what they're feeling. And then I could get into the state where, hang on a sec, you know, I don't deserve your anger. But would that be true? There must be an emotion inside of me that's attracted that to occur that I need to deal with. Can you see that?
Yeah.
And I need to focus on that. Yeah.
I just want to share something personal because, well, not me.
Can I just stop you for a second, though? Are you thinking about whether it's going to help everyone else here?
Yes.
No, but you said firstly that it's going to help you. I don't want to shut you down. I'm just...
No, I trust you.
No, no, no. Can you see what I'm getting at?
Yes.
What am I getting at?
To consider out others performing.
Why do you want anyone else here to feel things that you have gone through? Isn't that a projection? Isn't it? If I want you to understand what I've gone through, if I need you to understand what I've gone through, then straight away can you see that I'm needing something outside of myself? Can you see that? And if I'm needing something out of myself, is that love? No, it's not. You follow me? So ask yourself this question before you say what you want to say. What am I needing from this group? Why do I need to say this at this moment? What emotion within me am I denying in saying this? Because there is an emotion within you that you're denying. You follow me? Allow yourself to find what that is.
Two bombs worth there. I've often had the same feeling this lady's had, but she needs to put it out there.
Yep.
And it's a genuine desire that if somebody else finds themselves with the same problem, then perhaps what I've experienced would be helpful. And it's a genuine desire to be helpful, but I can relate to where I can realise that sometimes got me into trouble.
Be careful with these kind of desires, because these are the kind of the desires that we fool ourselves with quite often. When we feel that we're being helpful, when in reality that's driven by some very strong emotional neediness underneath that. Right?
But I
think
I need
you.
I was selfish in not sharing the ability.
So what's the feeling you're trying to avoid? you're trying to avoid the feeling of selfishness. You don't want to feel that.
And also, AJ, when you're saying these things, you're actually saying the story. And if you're saying the story, then you don't want the story to go away.
That's right.
In those terms, you're actually attracting it.
That's right. Yeah. But we do that because we're avoiding an underlying emotion.
Right.
Yeah. Which is one of these, isn't it? Can you see that? Yeah. Now, me saying that to you has hurt you in your heart.
No.
Yeah, it has, because I can feel it.
No.
Yeah.
I'm just reflecting upon what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I'm reflecting upon what you're saying.
But I'm saying to you, let yourself feel what the feeling is right now. Because I can feel the feeling from you right now.
Embarrassed, maybe.
So go underneath that. Can you see, like, I'll be doing this a lot with you over the next 2 days, right? It'll be challenging. After a while, you'll all wonder whether you want to put your hand up. My suggestion is, if I am humble, what's that again? What's being humble again? Desiring to feel everything that's moving, right? Including my embarrassment and my shame and my guilt and my everything within me, desiring to feel. If I'm humble, then these will be really good opportunities for us to. So, in other words, keep putting up your hand, put it out there. Get it chopped off, whatever is going to happen, let the law of attraction do its work, right? And be humble and let yourself feel what the result is. Let yourself feel that. Alright.
Can I just ask, feeling humble, being humble, isn't that going to attract people to you who will want to use that in a using you sort of way?
It's impossible to use a person who's humble. The reason why is the person who's humble is feeling their own emotions 24/7. So can they ever be out of tune with their own emotion?
No, but you can be sort of go for the ride. You can be your humble self, but and not realise what the other people are doing.
But you don't need to realise what the other people are doing.
Until it catches up with you later on.
But it won't catch up with you.
Take it for a ride or something.
No, but that would never happen if you were humble in the first place. Can everyone see why that would never happen?
Yes.
You sure you can see? Yeah. The law of attraction. If I'm completely humble, that means I'm feeling every emotion myself and not projecting any emotion outside of me. That means I'm owning every single emotion that's happening inside of me. So the law of attraction will very rapidly change, will it not? Will I ever attract a person? If I'm humble, will I ever attract being used? It's impossible. Like, it's only when I'm not humble that I'm going to attract someone being using me to trigger the emotion that I've just been avoiding. Does that, you follow that? Everything that goes on in your life, you will either avoid and need the law of attraction to expose it, or you will deal with it then and there and you will not attract it anymore. Like, the truth is that all of you, like I'm giving of my time and you're giving of your time here today, right? Now, it's cost me to give of my time, obviously. Obviously, I could be doing something else. I could be at home crying, actually. You know? That's what I feel like doing. But if we allow ourselves, right, in this transaction to feel everything, you cannot use me. You cannot use me in any way. If I allow myself to feel every emotion and I'm truthful about every emotion that I'm feeling. So for example, if all of you were angry with me and if I had some worthiness feelings that have been not dealt with, then I would get into my emotion and start crying, wouldn't I? If all of you were angry with me and I dealt with the worthiness emotion, I'd just say, all of you are angry with me. It's not a good time for me to be here. Catch you later.
Yeah.
And it wouldn't affect me at all. Right? Either way, the law of attraction would work for all of us. Yeah?
Is that lady's caution about humility related to that we get very confused? We confuse humility with being vulnerable, the vulnerability of humility. then you can give, we have a misunderstanding that that makes us, that disempowers us.
Yeah.
And therefore we're open to persecution, we're open to being attacked because we're disempowered, we're vulnerable.
Yeah.
We
often confuse it.
We confuse humility with being vulnerable and disempowered and weakness when it's actually the most empowering position to be.
Spot on. And often we confuse humility with being humiliated, and they are two totally different things.
I'm thinking of a person who might be totally all feeling, which is fantastic, totally secure in their life, and they're just, you know, gliding along, flowing along very calmly and naturally, and nothing's hurting them, or no obstacles, flowing smoothly. And you're attracting people who like that about you.
Yep.
But they're needing a calm person around them, but they're totally not.
Yeah, but if they're in, if that person, the original person, is attracting these needy people, then there's something within that person that still needs to be cleared. And I can, like, I know exactly what it would be as well.
Which is?
What do you think it might be? If I'm a humble person, but I'm attracting all these needy people that I'm always helping all the time, what's going on within me?
No self-worth.
I've got no self-worth. That I might be humble, but I have no self-worth. And I need to have self-worth, so I need to deal with the emotions of unworthiness. Yeah? That's the only reason why that would work, how that would work. Because I have unworthiness emotions inside of myself to deal with.
But if you've been sort of successful in what you're doing in your life,
but
you're
like,
happy with the way things
are. I was a multimillionaire, I was successful. But it doesn't mean that I didn't have huge unworthiness. Like you can be quite successful in the intellectual way, tuning out of your emotions, but you can not feel, you could still not feel some deep emotions of unworthiness. The truth is, I was attracting those people all the time, and totally blind to it at the time.
So put that in the perspective of healers.
Yep. In what way?
Well, people go into healing modes, and they are attracting people who that healer can help in some way.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to hear your thoughts.
Okay, well, why does the person want to heal?
Because they have to be healed themselves.
Usually that's the attraction. Okay. Yeah, usually that's the attraction. Yeah. So, like, and then someone said, but in the first century, didn't you heal? But yes, the answer was yes. But very rarely when I was asked to. Do you understand why? Because most of the time you're asked to, the person who's asking you wants to heal, wants to be healed physically, but doesn't want to deal with their emotions. And what caused their illness? Their emotions. So you know, if we've got and you may have a passion for healing. Let's say you have a passion for healing. Do you have a passion for healing and your own life being a mess? Or do you have a passion for healing and your own life is healed?
Yeah.
Now, if you have a passion for healing and your own life is healed, well, that's fantastic. That's then your passion. Follow your passion, just like any other passion. But if you have your own life as a mess and you're healing others, then what's that saying to you? You need to heal yourself. Yeah. There was in the Homecoming book, John Bradshaw mentions a lady who come to him. And he listed off all of these things within this was in the first few pages of the book. He listed off all these things that were going on within her life. They were all to do with, you know, issues of being raped and physically and sexually abused. And guess what she did as a job? She was a sexual abuse counsellor for women. So her attraction as a job, and that was her passion, but it was her passion only because of the emotion that she had yet to heal within herself. And you will find that yourself as you grow too. Your passions will change because you'll realise that the passion you had or that you thought you had was actually driven by a desire of something you needed inside of yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have a passion at the moment which I've totally turned my life around to do, and that is to help parents teach children how to feel at a very early age by allowing feelings to be passed through and expressed and supported.
So the question then becomes, am I choosing that job because I don't allow my own feelings and this is a way for me to work through that issue? Or am I choosing that job because I allow all of my emotions and I'm very passionate about that?
Sorry, so I have always been a feeling person. But it's that sense of there's so many children that aren't allowed to feel. And then thinking, well, what's the connection? Is there a connection?
You don't need to think too much, though, honestly. Like, if you're in a job at the moment, you're a healer, and you're there for a reason, right? Now, the reason is probably to do with your law of attraction, right? Let yourself be triggered. Let yourself be humble. Feel every emotion that comes up with every client. Isn't that the opposite of what they tell you to do when you're a therapist of some kind? You know, to detune or detach or disassociate from your client? Don't do that. Do the opposite. You're in that job for a reason. The law of attraction's at work. Let your emotions be triggered. Be humble. Let and desire all those emotions.
I just feel at the heart of what we're talking about, I think there's confusion around emotions, feelings, as being enemy. I think we actually talk about it and get contradictory, not even you, I just mean generally, that it's hard to get the concept that all our feelings are always right all the time. And unless we befriend our emotions and our feelings, really befriend them. There's no such thing as negatives and positives. They're all there for a reason. They're always right, all of the time.
Yep.
Unless we get that point, that understanding at a mind level, we'll always have an aversion to an emotion, and therefore we don't humble ourselves, and we don't want that emotion because it's bad. You know, we push it away, we repress it.
Yeah.
But it is never bad. Now, unless we get that,
the next step, which is finding out what's driving it.
Yeah.
And that brings up the issue of judgment, which is one of the tools of denial that we use. Whenever we judge the emotion. So, am I saying that anger is bad?
No.
I'm saying anger is a...
absent harmony.
It's a projection, isn't it? It's a denial of underlying. But am I saying don't feel your anger?
No.
Because what did I say to you this week? I was feeling angry. So I'm not recommending you don't feel your anger. What I'm saying is feel it and understand there is something underneath it. You need to love all of these emotions. They are all...
welcome.
Yeah, certainly.
Are you going to make a list of the...